You are listening to the Nat Turner Library Radio Network. If you are offended by black people discussing our suffering, black people discussing our struggle, and black people talking about solutions to our problems, then this show is not for you. You have been warned. Nat Turner, Library Radio.
Executive producer of the Nat Turner Library Radio Show. I'd like to greet you in the words of peace. We say it in the Arabic language, Assalamu alaikum, to my Christian family, praise the Lord for tonight, to my Hebrew family, Shalom, to the Black Power movement, such as the Black Panther Party and those that have no conformity to just say Black Power, and to the brothers and sisters who just want to greet this evening, I say good evening and welcome to another great hard-hitting subject matter. This, as I have said in maybe one or two other shows over the last 3 or 4 years, this tonight, brothers and sisters, is a subject that is one close to my heart. It's close to my heart because, one, you know, when you study conspiracies and you look at what happens to the black community, you've been working in the black community, you know, the things that solve the problems the most, that's the things you really, really, really want to talk about. You know, I can talk about what the Federal Reserve is doing. I can talk about what Trump said. I can talk about protests and here and there and what this group and that group is doing. But, you know, all of that pales in comparison if we can't keep our logic and our brain together. And so tonight's subject, one of my favorites of all time, one that's very close to my heart, tonight's subject, dealing with the hidden reasons for disunity in the black community. We did a show 2 years ago. For those who are adamant listeners of the Nat Turner Library Radio Show, we did a show a couple years ago, Hidden Reasons for Divorce in the Black Community. Well, you know, divorce is a form of communication or lack thereof. As we'll go through some statistics, you know, that's one of the main reasons for it, but also for black disunity. We have a lot of things going on within each group, you know, this group versus that group, but within the black community in general, we have a huge problem with disunity. And we're going to go through later on today with our guest, Brother Herrell, Counselor Herrell, who's worked in mental health for over a decade. And if you remember Dr. or Counselor Gerald King that we spoke to 2 years ago, he helped us to understand some things about trauma. And hopefully our brother today, Brother Herrell, later on, he'll be on at about 8:35, will come forward and discuss this same thing with us in detail. Well, brothers and sisters, I just wanted to give you some basic details of how to follow the show and how to look it up. Number one, go to our Facebook page, brothers and sisters. If you go to Facebook and simply type in Nat Turner Library Radio, you can actually see all of the hosts and the founders on the right-hand side of the Nat Turner Library Radio Network. What we do during the shows themselves is we actually post, whether it be different articles of interest or information concerning our guests that we may have or any subject that you would need to read. You know, you can find all of that on the Nat Turner Library Radio page on Facebook. We are also found on Instagram. If you go into the letter X method, simply 6X method. We're also on Twitter. And if you go into Twitter, you just simply type NTLR radio. That's NTLR, stands for Nat Turner Library Radio. And on YouTube, just type in the Nat Turner Library Radio on YouTube, and you will find our latest uploads where we take our shows sometimes and we upload them. And we have some videos from the past that are concerning various subjects that are relative to the show, current and past. And as I said earlier, brothers and sisters, welcome. Welcome and welcome to the Nat Turner Library Radio Show. You can call in if you wish to make comment, or if you just want to listen in, or you know someone who would need to listen in. You know, there's a lot of people who are driving, and they don't have good, you know, coverage for their Wi-Fi. You can just simply call in direct at area code 515-605-9882. That's 515-605-9882, and that'll get you direct live. If you want to make a comment or anything like that, we will get to you shortly in order to make those. Well, brothers and sisters, we have a couple of announcements. I thought our sister from the Marcus Garvey Day would be on with us, but she's a busy sister. There's a celebration going on next week, brothers and sisters, out in New York City. So if you're in the Harlem area, or if you are close by within a couple of hours of New York City, there's the African Nationalist Pioneer Movement. Sister Ya Asantewa. Sister Ya Asantewa. You can reach her at 929-345-6576. That's 929-345-6576. Or you can contact Brother Khalifa as well, of the founder of the Nat Turner Library. He will be, of course, having the second part of next week's celebration, which is the first annual Nat Turner Library Arts and Music Festival, which will be at the Nat Turner Library itself. That is a wonderful, wonderful event. We interviewed a couple days ago, Brother Kambada, who is one of the headliners. Yeah, he's a conscious rapper out of Connecticut. Very, very, very knowledgeable brother. Has some good clean music for those of us that enjoy that. But, you know, let's talk more about the ensemble of individuals that will be coming from the annual Marcus Garvey Day Parade. It's celebrating the 77th annual Marcus Garvey Day Parade. You know, Marcus Garvey was born in 1887. We all know that he was one of not the most successful black leaders at organizing black people. At one point, he had over 5 million of us inside of that. And so we have celebrating his birthday. We know Nat Turner's birthday is this month as well. So August is a very powerful month for black liberation. Our brother, Dr. Umar Johnson, who's been traveling around the world and will be headlining at the Marcus Garvey Day Parade, and he'll be at the Marcus Garvey Park in Harlem at 5 p.m. The parade is at 6. So if you want to assemble and you want to be in this parade, that's at the Marcus Garvey Park in Harlem, New York. And the theme, of course, is red, black, and green. There's a cookout all day from 12 noon, 10:30 to 10:30 p.m. Vendors are allowed. Tickets to this thing is $12. That includes live entertainment and presentations. It's at the Mecca Gardens where everyone is going to be assembling. This is next week on Friday, August 17th. That's at the Mecca Gardens, 2122 7th Avenue West, at 126th Street in Harlem, New York. That's 2122 7th Avenue West, 126th Street, right in the heart of Harlem, in Harlem, New York. And we'll be honoring attorney Alton Maddox. I remember when I was young, attorney Alton Maddox has been one of the few that have been always on the front lines in defending our people legally. And so have a good, good, positive day, you know. And then if you have the ability to, come on down to the Nat Turner tour, which will be the very next day right down in Southampton County, Virginia. And if you're in New York, the Nat Turner tour package is $250 a person. Transportation only is $125, and leaving 125th Street and 7th Avenue. that's on that night or the next morning, if you would. And so, of course, the very next day will be the Nat Turner event itself. The tour will be on Sunday, August 19th. But you can contact for all of this information about the Marcus Garvey Day Parade if you want to participate or you just want to get more information in detail. Contact our sister, Ya Asentewa, 929-345-6576. That's 929-345-6576. And so our sister was going to be on with us tonight to talk about that, but I think I gave all the information that you need. You can also email at 2140 at buyblackcampaign91@gmail.com. That's buyblackcampaign91@gmail.com. Beautiful weekend coming up next weekend, brothers and sisters. We got the Nat Turner Arts and Music Festival, first annual, next week at the Nat Turner property in Southampton County, Virginia. For more information on that, as I said last night on the Easy Light Sources show, I want you to go to easylightsources.org, and you'll see a big flyer on there. And this flyer will be available on the Nat Turner Library page on Facebook as well. So, brothers and sisters, if you're not a member or you haven't liked our page, please go to the Nat Turner Library Radio page and like the page, and you'll get a lot of these updates that we're talking about, a lot of the information that is being discussed. You'll be in the know, and you'll be a part of it. Share that information with our people. One of the things that we're going to discuss later tonight is that we have a problem with communication, it seems. You know, a lot of that comes not just from being black, but a lot of that comes from just our inabilities to deal with some of the coping skills that are needed just to basically communicate. And so that's the basic announcements. We were about to go into our news hour, our news segment. Brothers and sisters, our sister Tangela, are you there? All right.
Yes, Brother Mike, I'm here.
As-salamu alaykum.
Wa alaykum as-salam.
Thank you for joining us tonight, Sister Tangela.
Yeah, sorry about that.
Oh, no, that's quite all right. Our announcements that we had were a little shorter than normal. We were expecting our Sister Ya, but she's with us in spirit. Sister has been working hard the last couple of weeks.
Oh, yes, definitely.
And getting that Marcus Garvey, you know, she brothers and sisters are listening. You know, I was telling her, I said, Sister, don't get too distressed. I said, I've been dealing with black organizations and black groups and black events since I was a teenager. And,
right. Man,
everybody expects one person to do it all. And you remember, Sister Tangela, we was out in Memphis a couple of weeks ago. Student Minister Anthony Muhammad out in Muhammad's Mosque, number 55. Beautiful mosque, by the way, brothers and sisters.
Yes.
If you ever are out in Memphis, go and visit the Believers out at Muhammad Mosque, number 55. Beautiful believers, beautiful spirit, nice city, right on the Mississippi River. And he was saying that, you know, all the believers sometimes, they come to him saying and think he got the solution to everything. He said, I'm a brother like just like y'all. He said, come and pitch in and bring forth that. And I was telling Sister Ya that same thing. I was like, you know, deputize some people. Don't try to do it all yourself. You know, so she's working hard and getting Marcus Garvey Day up in Harlem ready. And, you know, Sister A.J. Jones and Sister Nadira Khalifa and my brother Khalifa Muhammad of all of the Nat Turner property are working hard for next week as well. And we ask Allah to give them the perseverance needed to organize such good events for our people. We need more good, positive events like this rather than going to these concerts where debauchery is going on and going to some nightclub. These are the things you want to spend your money on, brothers and sisters. So, Sister Tangela, what's been going on in the news this week?
The first article we have is an article by Emmy Magazine from Emmy.com. NFL's first male cheerleaders to make debut during preseason.
Say what?
NFL first male cheerleaders to make debut during preseason.
Male cheerleaders, Lord have mercy. Go ahead and read that article.
Quentin Perron and Napoleon Jennings will soon make history as the first truly is in the NFL. These two young men who are of the African American persuasion, they're from California. They made it through an extensive audition process to make the 2018 squad for the Los Angeles Rams. So apparently the Los Angeles Rams will be debuting these two cheerleaders.
Lord have mercy.
The New Orleans Saints will also be debuting male cheerleaders during the NFL preseason. Now, male cheerleaders is not an uncommon practice in college, because when I was in college, we had male cheerleaders, but they were basically as the men who were the base for the holding up the young women,
right,
who were doing their stunts and doing things of that nature. And,
right, right.
You know, but these guys seem to be actually going to be male dancers alongside the women.
Lord have mercy.
So it's going to be an interesting take to see what type of dancing they're going to be doing. Are they going to be more feminine, or are they going to be more masculine? So it's going to be interesting to see how they take this. But the fact that it's two black males kind of make you wonder, where are they going with this?
Well, you know, Sister Tangela, what was your comment on this?
Well, just like I was saying, you know, it's going to be interesting to see. I didn't see any of the preseason football games on Monday night, or whether or not they played this week or Thursday night, and I don't know if they actually debuted yesterday or not. I'm not sure of that, so I'm not sure of what. Like I said, it's going to be interesting to see the role that they play. Is it going to be feminized, or is it going to be masculine? So I'll wait on my comments to see how they're actually going to play this before I comment on it.
You know, I'm going to be nice about this.
Yes.
Because, as you just stated, Sister Tangela, yes, you go to high school games.
Yes.
You go to some of those Pop Warner football games. You know, I remember years ago, brothers and sisters, I was a football coach for, youth football. And I can truly, honestly say one thing, brothers and sisters. Yes, you do see males. However, they are not the dancing debut kind of people.
Exactly.
Now, the fact that these are two, and brothers and sisters, this article that Sister Tangela read is on the Facebook page for Nat Turner Library Radio. And all you got to do, brothers and sisters, all you got to do is just sit there and, take a look at this article. And you see the photo. You see the photo of these two brothers.
Yeah.
One looks like a regular brother, and one is clearly effeminized. You got
right.
Like you got lipstick on. And, you know, I'm one of those wait and see, but
yeah,
we know there's a conspiracy on effeminizing the black male.
Exactly.
And, you know, the white man is terrified of strong black men. You know, the brother that we're going to be interviewing in a few minutes, Brother Herrell, he's a big, strong brother, you know. I like to think I am, and, you know,
right.
Well, I remember when all three of us, him, myself, Brother Herrell, myself, and Big Steve, may God eternally be pleased with him, he's no longer with us, would be in the gym. You know, everyone else would look at us and be afraid, and big, strong black men, you know, white folk terrified of us just from looking at us for whatever reason.
Yeah.
And so they always look to effeminize the image of black males. I can't stand that. So that article, you know, touched a nerve. But brothers and sisters, go to the Nat Turner Library Radio page on Facebook. You'll see exactly what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
What's the next one you got for us, sister?
The next article comes from Chicago's Sun-Times.
Okay.
This article, Mitchell, Chris Kennedy takes low road by spreading conspiracy theory, written by Mary Mitchell.
Okay.
Chris Kennedy is right. Working class and poor blacks have been pushed out of the city of Chicago. Chicago black population has dropped by more than 250,000 people since 2000, according to the latest U.S. Census. But last week, the Democratic governor candidate placed the blame for the black exodus on the current mayor, Emmanuel Rahm's shoulders.
Okay.
But according to Mary Mitchell, she said that many of us was already saying the same thing long before the current mayor got into office, we said that the city was, CHJ had tore down miles of public housing on lakefront land and scattered poor black people like dust in the wind. We also said because it seemed that gang bangers were being allowed to boldly peddle drugs on our street corners and in front of our houses. We also said that when black children were being promoted from Chicago public schools without being able to read and write. And we also said that when small business owners disappeared, leaving behind empty strip malls and commercial districts. So we've been saying all along that we're being pushed out of the Chicago prominent areas.
Right, right. They do the same thing in Atlanta.
Yeah.
L.A., New York. You know, Brooklyn used to be black as midnight. Now you go to Brooklyn, New York. It's just like the, you know, the movie OG, or the series OG. They got people getting pushed out. But
yeah.
Continue.
Yeah, so, you know, the author of the article, she was just saying that now in a misguided effort to attract black voters, Kennedy, whose surname evokes a great deal of respect among older generations, has resurrected this old conspiracy theory.
Oh, old conspiracy.
Yeah.
You know, and brothers and sisters that are listening under the sound of my voice, read this article for yourself. Mm-hmm. We know good and well, it's called gentrification. We know gentrification happens.
Yeah.
They raise the prices in an area that
right.
they want, raise the taxes. I mean, they
yeah.
do it all over. They've been doing this since, you know, after slavery. And then they get black folk out of there, and then they have developers buy the area. You know, or worse yet, you know, Sister Tangela, they bring crime into the area. They bring drugs,
right.
and guns. You know, Ray Ray and Ray Ray and Raekwon and all them in the hood, they don't know how to read no international passport application, so they can't go over to Israel and get weapons or Germany and get weapons and stuff like
right.
that. You know,
yeah.
And so the question becomes in a city like Chicago, and we have a video called "What Is." If you go to YouTube, brothers and sisters. And you type in Nat Turner Library Radio, one of the videos that I had created last year was What is Nigger Life? And it deals with all of these types of so-called conspiracies and the reality of them. I got a clip of a brother from Chicago, two brothers actually, or excuse me, three, saying that, hey, in Chicago, the reason there's so many killings, and this has been going on for a decade, they say every morning, 2, 3 in the morning, there's boxes and crates of military-grade weapons and bullets being left there. Now, that's just straight out the street testimony. There is no politician talking. And we got several individuals for years saying that, and one of our sisters who was a congresswoman in Illinois who's saying the same thing.
Yeah.
So all of this is part of that conspiracy, but it's actually happening. It's not a conspiracy.
Yeah, I think that's what the author was trying to state, that, you know, that Kennedy is trying to bring forth this conspiracy when in actuality it's just facts.
Right.
You know, it's not a really conspiracy.
Yeah.
These are the facts
yeah.
of what's happening.
What's happening, right, right, right.
And the fact that he's trying to pin it on this current administration states that it goes far beyond just this one mayor and this one administration.
Well, you know, I talked about Rahm Emanuel a while back on Facebook. Rahm Emanuel's family is from Israel. They are Israeli operatives.
Mm-hmm.
And we know the motto of Israeli Mossad is by way of deception we do war, and we know nothing short of war is what's happening in Chicago. But who's in Chicago, Sister Tangela?
Right.
The Honorable Mirza Luz Farrakhan. The headquarters of the Nation of Islam. They stated themselves that we read last week in last week's show. They said the Nation of Islam is the number one group that's a thorn in the side of the ADL. So what better way to try to neutralize the headquarters than to put guns and all that stuff in there to try to neutralize the Nation of Islam? We see you, Satan. We see you. What's the next article you got, Sister Tam?
The next article is from the Chicago Tribune, written by Barbara Tucci. Facebook, Apple, silent conspiracy theorist Alex Jones, removing pages and podcasts.
Mm.
Yeah. Major tech companies have begun to ban right-wing conspiracy theorist Alex Jones from their services, reflecting a more aggressive enforcement of policies against hate speech and misinformation following protests on social media. Facebook has taken down 4 pages belonging to Jones, including 2 featuring his InfoWars show, for violating his hate speech and bullying policies. Over the past several days, Apple, YouTube, and Spotify have also removed material published by Jones. Twitter, which hasn't banned Jones, has also faced similar calls.
Mm.
Facebook has also suspended Jones' account for 30 days because he repeatedly violated the company's community standards against
hate speech that
attacks or dehumanizes others. It said in a statement Monday, Facebook did not immediately respond Monday asking what would happen after the 30 days are up and why it hadn't taken action earlier.
Well, they gotta go back and ask the ADL what to do next.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
The 30-day suspension of Jones himself appears to have gone into effect in late July.
Wow.
We have been banned completely on Facebook, Apple, and Spotify, Jones wrote on Twitter. We have conservative news outlets will be next.
Well, what's your comment on that, Sister Tamsin?
I think, you know, unfortunately for Alex Jones, it's sad that he's been targeted for, you know, he has a lot of different views in which a lot of folks do not agree with. So when you start stepping on toes of certain individuals, certain groups, then this is what happens. They try to censor you and try to take away all your rights to public speech.
You can't even speak. They don't even want you to speak.
Exactly.
Yeah, and brothers and sisters who don't know, Alex Jones, in the so-called revolutionary world, is one of the stalwarts legends, if you would, living legends. He's along the lines of David Icke and many others that I can go through the list that are, you know, white conspiracy guys. But,
exactly.
You know, these guys actually have spent most of their life talking about the truth of what happened.
Yeah.
You know, behind the scenes.
That's true.
Jeff Rentz is another guy.
Yeah.
You know, and what happens here right now is the ADL, the SPLC, and all the NABRIF that you had mentioned last week, Sister Tangela, in that article. They have control of the United States government. They actually pretty much conceded that during the President Obama's election, when we had Netanyahu come over here against his will, against
right.
President Obama's will, and spoke to both the House and the Congress. I mean, who does that? Goes to somebody else's house and start talking. I'll be damned if somebody come to my house and talking about they're going to do something.
Yeah.
Well, Netanyahu from Israel did that. So they don't like Alex Jones because he met with the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, had a civilized discussion.
Yeah.
He even went as far, Alex Jones, as to say, hey, you know, this man seems like a normal guy. Anyone who meets the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan has nothing bad to say about him.
That's true.
And so those who run the media, they got something to say. So, yes, brothers and sisters, this came out in the news today or a couple of days ago, and Alex Jones has been targeted by the same groups we talked about last week.
Exactly.
What's that next article we got, Sister?
The next article is from the psychiatry.org. Dr. Alta Stewart takes office as APA president, the first African-American to lead the organization. Article dated May 10, 2018. Alta Stewart, M.D., began her one-year term as president of the American Psychiatric Association at the conclusion of the APA annual meeting in New York on May 9th. At the same time, Bruce Schwartz, M.D., began his term as APA president-elect. Stewart is the first African-American to lead the APA and the fourth consecutive woman chosen to lead the association.
Okay.
She is an associate professor of psychiatry and director Center for Health and Justice Involved Youth at the University of Tennessee Health Science Center in Memphis. She has led several different positions within the organization, and she says she's looking forward to working with the internal and external stakeholders over the next 12 months to advance the goals of our organization and the profession of psychiatry around the world.
So, yes, ma'am, what do you have to say about this article and this sister here?
You know, I think it's a wonderful opportunity for Sister Stewart. I look forward to she states that she will be active in speaking about the challenges facing the nation and how they affect mental health, and she wants to thank her colleagues for putting their trust in her to lead the organization. So I'm looking forward to seeing what she can do in 1 year because
right.
she only has a one-year term. So, you know, I guess they couldn't get it twisted a full term, so they don't give
it. Oh, that's not a full term they gave her.
No, just a 1 year
term. Oh, Lord, they're going to see if she's going to play nicely.
Yeah, so
wow.
They're going to see. I know.
Wow. That's terrible.
But it's a great opportunity for her to, you know, come out of Memphis, Tennessee. I think it's a great thing, and I look forward to seeing what she can do for the psychiatric world.
Now, brothers and sisters, this sister, Dr. Alpha Stewart,
yes.
Who took office recently, we thank Allah for Almighty God for her. I talked with her, brothers and sisters, last year on the phone. She was on a radio show that I was listening to, and I called in, and I was able to speak to her directly. And I hit her with the questions that I'm going to talk with our guest tonight, Brother Herrell, who is a really, really good brother.
Yeah.
You know, these same questions I asked her. I said, hey, how do you feel about, you know, the African-American, you know, because they don't say black in that world. They say African-American, whatever that is.
Well, they do say black because she was actually the president of the Black Psychiatrists of America.
Well, good. You know, that's what they say. Well, they called her African-American. So I remember when I spoke to her, she talked about African. She said the word she used was African-American. That's the only reason I say that. So I asked her, I said, you know, with trauma being so prevalent in the black community and no group, no organization in government talking about it or looking for solutions, I said, what's the best way for us to handle this? You know, Dr. Stewart told me, she said, well, thank you for even bringing it up because, you know, no one else in that conversation that when she's on the show wanted to talk about black people and psychological trauma. But this sister here, Dr. Stewart, who was recently made a couple of months ago, she was recently made the president of the American Psychiatric Association. She actually said to me, she said, you know, the families of these individuals have to take them in and get them counsel because they need help. She said she thanked me for bringing it up, and she said she thanked me for handling what I had mentioned to her on air was some personal issues that I was having with my own family. And she said, it's tough. A lot of people don't realize how tough it is until they have to go through it, dealing with those who've been traumatized. And, you know, I thank you for that. So, Sister Tangela, you know, we're running late on time. We're going to hold the article that we have there to maybe later on.
Oh, sure. No,
okay. And but, brothers and sisters, the articles that we were talking about in the news, including the American Psychiatric Association's nomination of the first black woman that they've had, Sister Dr. Alpha Stewart, that I spoke to myself last year, is on the Nat Turner Library radio page. You have any more comments, Sister Tangela, about the news for tonight?
No, sure do not.
Well, I thank you, Sister Tangela, for the news. Brothers and sisters, that is Sister Tangela, our news consultant for Nat Turner Library Radio. Thank you again for another wonderful, great job with the news, Sister Tangela. Brothers and sisters that are listening, forthcoming after our commercial break, we have my brother, my friend, Brother Herrell. He is a good man. He is a good brother. The brother has been working in the mental health field for some time. And you hear our music in the background. That just means we're going to a commercial break. You're listening to the Nat Turner Library Radio Show. Hold tight. We'll get right back to you, brothers and sisters.
Realist and most accurate black news available on the planet. Finalcall.com. Fair, reasonable, accurate, and inclusive. We are a unifying website. Finalcall.com. Go there today.
This is your brother here, Michael Muhammad, executive producer of the Nat Turner Library Radio Network. Brothers and sisters, you have been listening to me speak for several years about a lot of subjects, and many of you know that I am a member of the Nation of Islam and a follower and student of the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. on. And, you know, I've read a lot of books about the Nation of Islam. Some are confusing, some are inaccurate. But let me tell you something about Khalifa Muhammad, the author. As you know, Khalifa Muhammad is my brother and friend, but he's also the writer of the groundbreaking book, which is called Frequently Asked Questions, Nation of Islam, Part 1. And, you know, there's a lot of questions out there that people ask. Is Farrakhan a hate teacher? Is the Nation of Islam an anti-Semitic group? Do you believe that the white man is the devil, they ask us? Who started the Nation of Islam? What does the Nation of Islam believe? And what does the Nation of Islam want? Well, we have these questions answered at the in the book, Frequently Asked Questions of the Nation of Islam, or Nation of Islam, Frequently Asked Questions, by Khalifa Muhammad, chairman of the Nat Turner Library radio show. He's also son of H. Khalif Khalifa and an assistant student minister of the Nation of Islam under the guidance of the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, with his time under Student Minister Abdul Sharif Muhammad of the Southern Region. Khalifa Muhammad has also served as a public school educator in New York and is familiar with all of the media slander that has been raining down on the black community by the enemies of truth about the Nation of Islam. So for once and for all, for many of you who think that there's some hidden agenda or we have something to hide, what I'd like you to do is to go right now to Amazon or KHA Books, that's KHABooks.com or Amazon.com, type in there Khalifa Muhammad.
Books. Family, I've been drawing and researching history since I was 6 years old. As the daughter of a Black Panther, early on, I was exposed to racial injustice and learned that our history was not accurately portrayed or even included in the standard textbooks. So I decided to harness that energy and created a collection of illustrated history books that honor the ancestors by building on knowledge of self. The mission of Black History Coloring Books is to eradicate cultural illiteracy by resurrecting those missing lessons that were somehow left out of the standard history books. This collection features books on Malcolm X, Emperor Selassie I, Mandela, Haiti, Dr. Sadie, Juneteenth, Marcus Garvey, and our latest edition family is the Black Panther Party for Self-Defense, Power to the People. Black History coloring books are not like typical coloring books. Each book is filled with lifelike illustrations, lots of historical research, first and fun facts, vintage photos, and family. They're for ages 8 to 88. They're collectible keepsakes for students, parents, grandparents, teachers, and history buffs. Black History in February, what? Over here, we declare every month is Black History Month because one month could never tell our story. Family, I invite you to add Black History coloring books to your home, office, or school reference library. For the price of lunch, you can have your own Black History coloring book, and I'll autograph it just for you. I invite you to visit my website, family, at blackhistorycoloringbooks.com. Support a black author. Support black businesses. But most importantly, family, increase your knowledge of self. AJ Jones, look forward to building with you. Peace and love.
It's your brother here, Michael Muhammad from Nat Turner Library Radio Show. Brothers and sisters, I have recently launched my new writing, Checkmate, The War for the Black Mind, a part one, which is dedicated to the study of the mind of the black woman and how our enemies have attacked the black woman to get to the ultimately the black community. But I also have a website, bromichaelmuhammad.com, bromichaelmuhammad.com. That's bromichaelmuhammad.com. On this, you will see me. You will see the M6X apparel, which has beautiful shirts, 100% organic black shirt. For the sisters, we have the Be Yourself, Love Yourself shirt, the shirt that says, I'm not a toy for a little boy, I need a man with a plan. And for our conscious sisters, modesty is loving yourself. When you disrespect women, you destroy the future for everyone. We have the shirts of 100% organic black, which gives all the attributes of our organic black man and woman. We have Honor Thy Mother and Thy Father. We have the 100% black God shirt, one of the most popular. We have the Know Your Enemy shirt with the atrocities that have happened to the black man and woman of North America on the back. We also have the Checkmate book cover shirt in many different colors. We also have fragrances are available. You just simply have to tell me which one you need. And these are all the things you can find on bromichaelmuhammad.com. That's bromichaelmuhammad.com. The website, you can go to it from your e-reader. You can go to it from your tablet. You can go to it from your PC. You can also reach me directly at michaelasia33@gmail.com. It's M-I-C-H-A-E-L-A-S-I-A. 33@gmail.com. You may also call me direct at 678-906-6306. Peace.
Peace, you guys. It's Nadira here from Easy Light Sources. And I just wanted to let you know that the Easy Light Sources Food Guide is now available for $10 on easylightsources.org. The Easy Light Sources Food Guide covers 18 fruits and vegetables commonly found in any grocery store. If you're looking for ways to feel better in your life and to raise your vibrations, one of the easiest ways to incorporate some light into your life is through the foods that you eat. If you're interested in going into a plant-based lifestyle, the Food Guide also has your back with a few essays in the back and a few recipes to help get you started. Once again, the Easy Light Sources Food Guide is now available. Purchase your copy today at easylightsources.org.
Matt Turner, Library Radio. Brothers and sisters, this is Brother Michael Muhammad from Nat Turner Library Radio. We are going into our interview segment with our brother, Herrell, our counselor, who's been working with people in this field for a very, very long time. He is on the line with us. But brothers and sisters, before we do that, I just want to play a little clip, brothers and sisters, just a little clip. About what childhood adverse childhood experiences studies are. Just a couple minute clip, we'll get right to the interview with our brother Herrell.
And the Children's Resilience Initiative.
We're talking about adverse childhood experiences.
So what kinds of lifelong physical, mental, emotional, behavioral outcomes of ACEs are we talking about?
Some of the things that can be affected when someone goes through a traumatic situation can be the thinking, the social, and the mental health of the person.
So the more ACEs that you have, it increases your chances of screwing up as an adult.
There are 9 ACEs.
Physical abuse.
That much of the sexual abuse that goes on within families and within extended families.
Verbal abuse is something very serious.
Right now, many of the kids in our valley are having the experience of not having their basic needs met.
When a parent is mentally ill with depression or anxiety, this causes the child to have to fend for themselves. When a parent is addicted to substances, their priorities are not in order.
It's very clear that for a child to witness domestic violence can be extremely impactful.
My parents divorced when I was 2, and I had 5 stepfathers, and I never had a positive male role model.
89% of the kids who are in juvie in Walla Walla have a family member in jail.
We're going to look at how early childhood experience shaped how our brain develops.
Research shows that people who've been through trauma, their brains are physically different from other people who haven't been through trauma.
The cortex is the center for thinking and judgment. If ACEs like sexual abuse occur in early childhood, the cortex is actually changed. This change affects the child's later ability to think things through and to have good judgment.
So growing up, we need our laughs, we need our hugs, we need our kisses We need our food. We need a, you know, a nice blanket to keep warm.
Race.
Yes, 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 yes. We do need a nice blanket to keep warm, brothers and sisters. Brother Herrell, are you there, brother?
Yes, I'm here, sir.
All right. Peace and blessings to you and your family. Welcome to the Nat Turner Library Radio Show, Brother Herrell. Brother Herrell, thank you for coming on. Brothers and sisters who are listening, let me give you a disclaimer. This is one of those subjects that we're going to talk about some very hard issues that may be disturbing to some. Not because there's anything wrong that we're talking about, but you may have experienced some of the things that we're going to talk about in this next hour or so. And I just want to warn you, but you are safe with us, brothers and sisters. We are not here to talk cavalier or demean anything that you may have experienced. We just want to make sure that you understand the nature of this. Brother Herrell, I got a quick question for you. You just heard the ACE, or Adverse Childhood Experience, definition as given by the professionals. From your experience, what do you think of that clip, you know, about the information on it?
With my experience, working with juveniles was I got majority of my experience from. And what I did learn from them was a lot of the reasons why they acted out, whether it be behaviorally or sexually, was due to some type of trauma. Most of the young men I would work with, they felt like someone had abused me physically, and then it came down on them emotionally, and they felt like, well, this was the right thing. This happened to me, so I'm going to do it to someone else, because they never talked about it.
Right, right.
They just hid things for years, and they never told their parents. They never told on the person that offended on them. And until they came and were in our center, they would say, oh, I'm just here for anger. Oh, I'm just here so I won't go to jail. But then when you get deeper and deeper into their treatment, then everything comes out. And they were, like, you know, very emotional because they were basically embarrassed. And I was listening to their little clipping, and they were saying, if I'm in juvie, someone in my family is in juvie. And that was almost about 97% true.
All right.
A lot of the trauma that we deal with in our community is always pushed down, and it's just suppressed. And they just say, just deal with it and get over it, because you don't want to go through the whole process, or you don't want to get anybody in trouble. And most of the time, they would display some signs that something was going on, but the family would ignore it. The mother would ignore it. The father would ignore it and just say, well, they're just acting out, or they're just spoiled because they want something. But we all know that things go deeper than that.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Brother Herrell, thank you for that. Let me introduce you I'm talking to you as though the audience know who you are. I've known you for nearly 20 years, but introduce yourself to the people. Tell them a little bit about yourself and how did you get into this field.
I come from a large family down here in Hampton, Virginia. I had went to college to work in business and computers. And a friend of mine saw me at one of the local department stores and said, he asked me, man, did you ever think about being a counselor? And I was like, yeah, I would love to do that. And that was over 10 years ago. And once I got in, I immediately – you know, just jumped right in and was able to just do my work and continue to do my work as of today, because I just got this thing inside of me that I want to help, and I have empathy for people who have dealt with these certain type of issues. And I got a lot of that from my mother. I got a lot of from my mother who has passed away in September.
May God be pleased with her. She made a wonderful son. She made a wonderful son.
Thank you. And she had instilled a lot of those things in me, and I was able to give them to other individuals that I still continue to deal with on a daily basis.
Well, you know, that's there it is, brothers and sisters. You know, Brother Herrell, you know, you and I know what trauma is based on definition, but brothers and sisters who are listening, if you go to Facebook and go to the Nat Turner Library Radio page, I put the definition, according to Merriam-Webster, the definition people, of what trauma is. And it defines it like this, Brother Herrell. It's an injury. Now, in this case, it could be physical or psychological. But an injury to a living tissue or psychological tissue, in this case, a disordered psychic or behavioral state, resulting from severe mental or emotional stress or physical injury. So,
absolutely.
Definition 1B. Now, this is a heavy load. You know, first time, Brother Herrell, I heard about the term trauma, I was like everybody else, just like what you were saying earlier. I was one of those, man, get over it type of people, you know. Because, you know, especially I'm like you, we dark-skinned brothers. And you grow up a dark-skinned, big black man, you know, got a bassy voice. You know, nobody care about you, man, you know.
Right.
Nobody looks out for you. You can't cry. You can't have emotions.
Right.
Nobody really
right.
asks you how you feeling, you know. You know, the only time you get taken care of is if you're real sick, like with the flu or something.
Right.
And, you know,
right.
You know what I'm talking about. I haven't seen this before. So with us black men, man, we're not allowed to even think about trauma. We like my whole life was traumatic. You know, and let me say this, brothers and sisters, Brother Herrell, I want you to chime in on this discussion.
Okay.
Let's start from the very beginning. We came to the shores of North America 400 years ago.
Right.
And from the moment we got here, we was traumatized. We were beat. We were raped.
That's it.
We were, you know, molested. We got killed. We seen our parents killed, children killed, all of that. That's trauma, mm-hmm. and that happened for nearly 400 years.
That's right.
And then our grandparents, your grandparents and mine, they had to come out of that with no counseling at all, with no therapy
right.
at all, and raise families. So, brothers and sisters,
right.
this ain't about blaming your mama, your daddy, your grandpa and all them, and your grandma for what they did wrong to you. Because believe me, as I've said, Brother Herrell, if you black in America, more than likely something happened to you traumatic. You know, because
right.
ain't nobody got counsel. That wasn't even heard of until recently, you know.
Right.
And so, So, Brother Herrell, I want to ask you a question about your experience, you know, with the people you've had to deal with. Now, this subject, brothers and sisters, ain't just a black subject. This is white.
Right.
This is Hispanic. We realize right. that. But we're dealing with our people because we never got counsel before as a people for experiencing
right.
that. So, you know, we want to deal with the worst first, and that's us, black men and women of North America. So my question
right.
to you, brother, is there's a brother or there's a sister listening to this show, right, whether it be today or in the future, young or old, and I want you to tell them right now what is considered to be trauma based on your experience, like what actions can that has happened to them is considered to be damaging to their psyche. Can you do that for us right now?
Trauma is something that has been like a detriment to the emotional, physical state of an individual. It's like an event that has caused, you know, that has caused pain, that has caused grief, that has caused a lot of headache, not sleeping at night, always worrying about something. Those are the effects of trauma. Trauma can, you know, trauma is not always a physical thing where someone did something. Some people develop trauma through not having enough money to pay bills. Some people
right.
develop trauma just through living in a neighborhood that's filled with violence. That's why they have PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, because
right.
they have
right.
that. They're always worried that something bad is going to happen. And, you know, most of the individuals that I've dealt with were living normal in college. Then some type of break happened where back in the day they will say they had a nervous breakdown or they lost their mind, which is true. But those are the words that they used to use. But now it's just like an event happened and it just brung them down. And that event was so traumatic that it just worked in on the psyche. It just worked in on the brain until the person just said, oh, I can't take this no more. And we all
right.
have dealt with that. We
right.
all have dealt with that. But thankfully,
right.
some of us are strong, and a lot of us are strong due to our families. Our families always being there for us. Some of these people had strong families. Some of them didn't have strong families. But a lot of ones that had these breakdowns, and now they're on medication and going to therapy, they're actually, you know, what they're actually doing is standing out and actually taking a chance at something different.
Right.
Because like you said, when we grew up, most of us didn't know anything about counseling. I didn't know anything about all the counseling centers in my surrounding area of Hampton Roads until I started working in the field. And I was like, wow, I rode past this building 100 times growing up. I didn't even know this was here. Or I rode past this clinic. I'm thinking this is a place people going for medical attention. But most people going there to get psychiatric attention, psychiatric
right.
counseling
right.
or things like that.
Right. So you know, here's a brother or sister listening right now to you. You know, could be someone that you and I know, could be someone that's a stranger, and they're like, man, nobody go get counseling. You know, what I need counseling
right.
for? I'm just fine.
Well,
I'd like to say these words, brother Herrell. You know, to that brother or sister who's listening, and you think that way. Let me repeat the words of a little white guy told me this, who was a counselor in Virginia. You know, we were talking on this subject. It was the first time I ever had to deal with this subject on my own personal life, you know, because I had to deal with some of those anxiety disorders in early on, you know, and I didn't even know what it was until my medical doctor said, well, what you're experiencing is anxiety panic disorder. I said, say what? I ain't scared of nothing. You know, I that's me, big black man. I'm like, I ain't scared of nothing. He said, no. He said, anxiety and panic disorder have nothing to do with fear necessarily. It has to do with a stress response, he said. I said, well, what do I do for it? He said, well, I don't deal with that. He said, you got to see a mental health counselor. I said, doctor, I ain't crazy. You know, this is years ago. You know, that's me. You know me. I was sitting there, man, I ain't nothing. You know, so I went to this guy because, you know, I went to the job the next day, and I thought everything was going to be all right. Next thing, I started having these panic attacks again. And next thing I know, I'm sitting in the counselor's chair, and I told the guy straight up, you know, I'm like, man, I ain't crazy. I ain't nothing wrong with me, man. You know, I ain't trying to hear none of this counselor stuff. You know, I'm just being a brother. You know, I was 27 at the time, I think, you know.
Mm.
And so the counselor said to me these words, and I'm going to repeat it to you brothers and sisters that are listening that are saying the same thing I said. His words are, he said, Michael, you went to a medical doctor, right, to get a medical health checkup. I said, yes, yeah. He said, do you ever get your knee checked out? I said, yeah. He said, what kind of doctor you had to go to? I said, orthopedic. He said, you ever had an X-ray? Yeah, I said, yeah. He said, those are called radiologists. He said, you ever had someone check your heart? I said, yeah, they call cardiologists.
Right.
He said, all these systems in the body, he said, need to be checked out. Why do you think the human brain don't need to be checked out?
Right.
And I smiled, Brother Herrell, and I said, man, you're right. And so I continued with the therapy, man. He had me do something that I didn't want to do, just like the brother and sister that's listening. He had me listen, talk to him about some of the most painful things that were still bothering me. A lot of it had to do with my mother. You know, this is not a,
wow.
You know, I'm not exposing nobody, but I'm saying because I love my
right.
mother. She's like yours, she's no longer with us. She was a wonderful woman, but, you know, our parents and people who we love can still negatively affect us, and they not intentionally negatively affect us. In other words, they don't know that they did that to us. It's not that they bad, but it's like
right.
that accident. It's like that car accident, brothers and sisters. Nobody intentionally hits you, but they still messed your car up, you know?
Yeah.
So I had to go, Brother Herrell, I had to go to some places in my mind I didn't want to go. You know,
right.
and then that layer of the onion got peeled, and then something else, and before you know it, I'm breaking down, I'm tearing up, but I found
right.
some relief with that, and, you know,
yeah.
I'm not 100%, but I'm getting better, and brothers and sisters, I'm saying
right.
that to you to say that's the same for you. Don't hold nothing back, man. Don't hold nothing
right.
back. Yeah, so Brother Herrell, I want you to continue on what you were saying.
And then I was thinking about what you said about your mother, and like you know, we've talked about this before, like mothers were doing their job, but you know, back
right.
in those days, it was all about if you act up, I'm gonna go get a switch or a belt or stitch
right.
and whoop you.
Right.
Because I
right.
want you to stop doing what you're doing. But in actuality that just causes, you know, more and more,
yeah. more trouble,
and more
right.
pain. Yeah. Even though some of those whoopings or whatever kept us from going to jail and kept us from
right.
getting beat by the police. But what about those people who dealt with those from their mother, that discipline, and they still wind up going into the penal system, wind up, you know, still committing acts that were violent, and, you know, it's just kind of like an ongoing thing. And, like, those were those different generational times. And it's like now you can't do that to kids, you know, nowadays. Like,
right, right.
Because it's just different. And, you know, a generation of the Book of Psalms lasts 70 years. And it's just like some things you have to learn how to evolve from, you know. And I get it that I know for single moms, I know it's kind of hard to be like, well, my son acted up at school. I didn't have no choice but to beat him. And I understand that. But it's like it has to be different alternatives to, you know, deal with those type of issues. And that's where trauma comes in there, because it's just on and on and on. Like some of us talk to our great-great-grandparents, our grandparents, and they'll tell you some things, and you're like, man, why are they saying like that? Why are they so harsh? Why do they have to come off
yeah.
with words like that? Yeah, rough.
Yeah.
And then you got to think
right.
about it. Well, if your great-grandparents, let's say if they were still alive, they would probably be like 120 or
right.
110
right.
years old. Well, 110 years ago, we were still dealing with slavery on a daily basis.
Right.
We were still dealing
right.
with those effects of getting whooped by the master, not getting fed and put in a hold, and you get up the next day and you back out in the cotton field. We were still dealing with those things 110 years ago. They might not say it. They might not put it out there. But,
right.
you know, those are the things we were dealing with. And just as today I was getting in my car at work, and I was just like, man, I'm feeling this heat. I just started to think about what my ancestors went through. And
right.
they didn't have a choice to get in their car and sit in the air conditioner and then pull off. They had to deal with that trauma of being out there in the field for hours. And then if you didn't
right.
take a certain amount of cotton, you got
right.
That's just like going to school. If I don't get all A's and B's, I come home, I know I'm going to get beat. You know, it's those
mm.
same different trauma effects happening today.
Now, what you're saying is right on point, brother. You know, I remember, you know, years later after speaking to some child counselors, you know, because I remember when I got custody of my sons, I had a child counselor, a very good sister here in Atlanta, who, you know, I told her straight up, I said, you know, I'm you know, I'm, that's my children, but I want to make sure I'm doing right by them. So I asked her, I said,
right.
you know, what should I do? She told me, don't spank them. I said, don't spank them. I was like, well, I got whooped like a slave when I was younger, you know. She laughed, and she said, and she gave me two sessions now. This counselor
right.
gave me two sessions of teaching on why corporal punishment is not good. And the
right.
one thing I gathered from that is the minute you strike somebody, I mean, even if you defend yourself, the body retains that memory of that assault.
Right.
So, you know, we don't understand that, because I don't know if you got beat like I did. I got beat just for no reason sometimes, you know.
Well,
I mean, I mean, one time I came home from school, your mother came home, rah, 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 boom, I got beat just for looking at it. I was like, Lord have mercy, you know. I got beat with
well,
a wire hanger. I mean, I'm not trying to make a confession. I'm just trying to make a point, because like I told her, I was like, when you get beat like that, and I know a young man right now who
uh-huh.
got beat so bad that his mama tried
uh-huh.
to kill him, and she didn't realize she was trying to. But
right.
you know, any time you whoop a child in the shower, and any time you
mm-hmm.
you know, whip a child with this and that, extension cords, withhold food from them, lock them in a cage.
Right.
You know what I mean? I hear these stories, and I'm like, wait a minute, what kind of parenting? Well, we know that if you trace all that back, that came from somebody's mama who taught it to somebody else, got it from someone else, and that's called pathology. Pathology, brother and sister. And so, Herrell, before we go to our next break, I want to ask you a question and tell the audience this. So, single mothers, I have an affinity and a love for them. Them sisters go through some tough stuff, you know.
Absolutely.
Raising a black child or a child, period. I don't care if you're white, by yourself in this country, man, that's traumatic just for the mama. So here's a mother who works all day long. She can barely afford daycare. You know, what should she do? Or even the single father, you know, because we got single fathers out there. What should they do, the parent, when they frustrated, tired, and all they know is they got to whoop their child because they got a call from the teacher, and the teacher, you know, I'll tell you a quick story. I went to the Boys and Girls Club picking my sons one day when they were younger. Young sister got suspended from the Boys and Girls Club because she was cussing. So the single mom picks up her daughter and says, I'm going to beat your A because you was effing cussing. I don't know where you get these effing words from.
Right.
You see how hilarious that is?
Yeah.
She's yelling at her daughter, say, when you get your A home, I'm going to beat your A because I don't know why you effing cussing. She's saying the full word, obviously. And I'm sitting there amazed, like, she don't know where her child cussing from. So I'm sure the child got whooped good, you know. I'm sure, like any other child, I'm sure she got beat like a slave. And the question that as a brother to a counselor, you know, I would say, I'm going to play devil's advocate. Let's say that was me. So my question to you would be, what should I do? My child done acted up, you know, and I got beat like this, so what should I do? You don't want me to beat him, what should I do?
Well, the first thing I would say you have to do, I know you're going to be upset because that's just a natural emotional feeling. You need to just calm down because you get to the point where you hurt your child. You know, some kids have been beat. Some kids have been, made their parents so upset, the parent, you know, slammed them or threw them down and, you know, they got hurt, paralyzed, or even died. That's the first thing we all need to develop to do because we got to understand children are children. They're going to do these things. Regardless, a lot of kids' behavior is learned behavior. Like you said, the young lady was cursing. She heard her mother cursing.
Right.
It's learned behavior. Like we got to understand with children, man. Like I said, they do things that their friends do, that their family do, that, you know, some will say, well, mommy, why are you always frustrated? Or mommy, why are you always angry? And the mother's angry because she's out working all day, sweating, doing whatever. The boss might have been down on her back. And then you get a phone call at 2 p.m., 2:30 when school done let out. You about to get off at 4. And the teacher done called and said, hello, Miss Jones, your daughter was doing this and that. And you like, oh, man, it's something else I got to add to my plate. And you go home and you just ready to let it all out on your child, but you're really not letting out you're really not getting the child for what they did. You're really releasing your anger from what happened to you at work. And the first thing I would say you have to do is to calm down and take time to yourself. And then come back and address, you know, what happened in school because, you know, so sometimes teachers they're petty. I know me in third grade, I had a teacher, man, you know, I was a fairly tall guy, large. Everything I did was Herrell had a bad temper. And I'm coming home bringing a note to my mom. And you already know what happened after that. You know, it's a couple notes I didn't bring home, but, you know, it's all good now. But even those notes that I didn't bring home, I was like, 10 years later, I was like, man, I wonder if my mom ever found it, but whatever. Sometimes you got to learn how to, you know, calm down, you know, try not to be so angry, calm down, take time to yourself and then go in there and process, you know, with the child and try to come up with some different ways or different alternatives to deal with these things. Try to come up with options try to come up with different punishments and disciplines rather than whooping. Because right now with the technology age, and we're all on our cell phones and stuff like that, and on our laptops and iPads and PlayStation. You know, you got to think about different things instead of going overboard.
I agree. Well, Brother Herrell, we're going to go to a quick commercial break, and when we get back, I want you to talk with the audience. We're going to talk about how to recognize the symptoms, brothers and sisters, of when you have a family member, you know, because we're going to identify what some of the more prevalent traumas in. And Brother Herrell, I did a survey for the audience, and we got quite a few responses back, and I want you to translate what you're seeing in these statistics about our people, and I'll tell you what I can see.
Okay.
And so, all brothers right. and sisters, when we get back, we're going to talk about trauma. We're going to talk about all those things that, you know, you like to hide in the closet, but we're going to expose them today. Hey, I put myself out there. It's time for you to look at yourself, and we're going to talk about these things. So when we get back, we're going to get over this subject as best as we can. You're listening to Nat Turner Library Radio.
Nat Turner Library Radio.
Nat Turner Library Radio.
Nat Turner Library Radio.
This is your brother here, Michael Muhammad, executive producer of Nat Turner Library Radio. I want to tell you about a beautiful store. It is Your Supermarket. That is Your Supermarket, owned and operated by student minister Abdul Sharif Muhammad of Muhammad Mosque number 15 here in the big city of Atlanta. That is located at 766 Joseph E. Boone Boulevard. That's 766 Joseph E. Boone Boulevard in Atlanta, Georgia. Phone number is 470-305-7910. That's 470-305-7910. In this store, everything is black-owned. We have the Eden Fresh products, which includes the toothpaste, body oil, shower gel, and deodorant. We also have the Eden's Spring Farms canned navy bean soup, the Eden Spring Farm okra and tomatoes, jams and jellies, and bread and butter pickles. It was also the Any Bean Necessary Organic Coffee, medium and dark roast, and medium dark roast ground and whole bean. There's the Miranda Fly Natural Hair Butter, and we also have Believer-owned Freedom Toilet Paper, as well as True Laundry Detergent, all of which are black-owned. We also have our beloved Muhammad Farms products. That includes Muhammad Farms Flour, Muhammad Farms Navy Bean, the canned beans, as well as the canned vegetables, as well as Muhammad Farms Cream of Wheat, and sometimes Muhammad Farms seasonal products. All of this is at Your Supermarket. It is called Your Supermarket, 766 Joseph E. Boone Boulevard in Atlanta, Georgia. That is the Bluff, the historic Bluff area. Phone number is 470-305-7910. Accept your own and be yourself. Go support Your Supermarket.
Peace, you guys. It's Nadira here from Easy Light Sources. And I just wanted to let you know that the Easy Light Sources Food Guide is now available for $10 on EasyLightSources.org. The Easy Light Sources Food Guide covers 18 fruits and vegetables commonly found in any grocery store. If you're looking for ways to feel better in your life and to raise your vibrations, one of the easiest ways to incorporate some light into your life is through the foods that you eat. If you're interested in going into a plant-based lifestyle, the food guide also has your back with a few essays in the back and a few recipes to help get you started. Once again, the Easy Light Sources food guide is now available. Purchase your copy today at EasyLightSources.org.
FinalCall.com. FinalCall.com. One word, FinalCall.com. The award-winning website for the realest and most accurate black news available on the planet. FinalCall.com. Fair, reasonable, accurate, and inclusive. We are a unifying website. FinalCall.com. Go there today.
Nat Turner Library.
Nat Turner Library Radio.
Nat
Brothers and sisters, we are back from our break, talking about a very, 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 very serious subject, the hidden psychological reasons for black disunity. We're going to show why black disunity happens because of these traumatic things. So stay tuned, brothers and sisters. Brother Herrell, are you there, sir?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay. Brother Herrell, real quick, before we go dive into this subject a little deeper and then close out the show, I want to play, brothers and sisters, a clip from Dr. Joy DeGry. Dr. Joy DeGry is author of a great book that I read. I have it right next to me in my hand. It's called Post-Traumatic Slave Syndrome. And for those who are not familiar with the word syndrome, syndrome means a problem that has multiple facets. She's a well-known international psychologist. And I want you to hear, she was addressing a group of white colleagues about what happened to us, Brother Herrell. So stay tuned. Take a listen. This is Dr. Joy DeGry, author of Post-Traumatic Slave Syndrome.
Uncomfortable.
Gotcha.
But that's okay, because it's been uncomfortable living in this skin. It's been uncomfortable. And we have to learn how to deal with that discomfort and stay in the room. So when we look at the fundamental premise of trauma, and we understand the nature of trauma, we know that there have been other groups that we've looked at the etiology of their of contemporary behavior based on multi-generational trauma. One group, Jewish Holocaust, families of Jewish Holocaust, and the fact that the Jewish community is very, very clear about honoring that Holocaust. So much so that Spielberg will probably make another movie. And I'm not mad at him, because what he's doing is ensuring that the generations that come will never forget the Holocaust and its impact upon Jewish people. You'll look at folks throughout the world, even Aboriginal folks in the United States, where more focus is being done on what colonialism has done. We've looked at Japanese internment. We've looked at Australian Aboriginal folks. We've looked at multi-generational impact of trauma on people who have had tragedies like the tsunami victims. We'll look at everybody. But when it comes to looking at Africans, there's a visceral response. Oh, come on, let's not. Why are you? And it's a curious thing as a social scientist to me that you get so much pushback when you talk about Africa. And we look at the legacy of slavery. You get so much pushback, but more importantly, it's why do you get the pushback? See, as a social scientist, I'm less concerned with the material, which I'm clear about. I'm more interested in why the behavior. Why is there such reticence at looking at this issue? And the answer is, when you peel back the layers of this, we peel back everybody's layers. Everyone gets naked in this room, and that's not always comfortable. It's also very comfortable to talk about the other's pathology. And the reason why I think that becomes important is so that when we begin to engage in this discussion, we don't find ourselves falling victim to the fear, guilt, all of that stuff that's not useful to anyone. It's not useful. This means we're going to peel the layers back. And while 246 years, as it were, in American history of American chattel slavery, starting with 1619, to the ratification of the 13th Amendment in the United States, we're looking at 246 years of American chattel slavery. And it's very comfortable, and I think to some degree people can say, you can't have 246 years of trauma and expect that nothing happened, especially when that trauma was followed by more trauma, especially given the fact that there was never a point of healing. Not difficult to do the math here. This is not deep and philosophical. It really makes sense. But you know what else is true? You can't have 246 years of folks engaged in a traumatic experience that were white that went unaffected. That means everybody has been affected and infected by this thing. We can actually kind of grow that list. Now we're going to move over to black racism. Tell me the ways in which black racism adversely impacts the lives of white people as an entire group. Thank you. The reason why you become silent is one that always comes up, and that's fear. White people are afraid of black people. They are afraid of us. And it's a very interesting thing because black people know it. We know white people are afraid. But you have to start getting into the psychology. What are you afraid of? Why are you afraid? But it's an interesting dynamic. Now, also you see the difference in what racism is, do you not? Racism implies you have not just prejudice, but the power to do something with that prejudice. Now, I don't like you, not only that, but I'm going to control whether you can get, you know, I may say I hate you. I hate white people. I hate them. It's not going to change you getting that, you know, loan when you go to the bank. I can hate you all the way to the bank. Not going to change. You see the difference? That whereas white racism says, not only do I not like you, but I'm going to change the impact of where you can live. I'm going to determine with that racism where your powers are. You following me? And I'm talking about as a group, not an individual, because people said, I remember when my uncle didn't. I'm not talking about your uncle. I'm talking about the whole group. I'm not talking about an incident. That's a difference. But white people are afraid. So let's get into how this fear impacts criminal justice. Because if white people in this room are afraid of black people, guess who else is afraid of black people? Only they have guns. So, now let's...
She's a sister. That was Dr. Joy DeGry, brothers and sisters. She's a sister that speaks the truth. She spoke the truth. And she's a New York Times bestseller. And she was featured on Oprah. And I can truly say, Brother Herrell, that what she was talking about with trauma and black people is absolutely true. The challenge is for us, you know, are we willing to face our own individual? This is not about blaming white folk. This is about, you know, that. So I want to lead that into and see if you had any comments on what Dr. Joy DeGry had to say, Brother Herrell. Do you have any comments on what she said?
Yeah, in my research and in my studies, I was thinking about, I came up with violence. One of the main reasons that we experience mental illness in the black community is violence. We're so used to violence, you know, from 300 or 400 years ago. We are so used to violence of the 50s and the 60s with the whole civil rights movement. And now President Reagan dropped the whole drug thing in our communities, and that's what most of our violence towards each other is over. So are drugs and prostitution. And a lot of the things that she was saying is absolutely correct. Like, if she said, if you're in a room, the Caucasians are frightened or fear of the black man, and someone else is going to be in fear of the black man, and that is the police. There's just so many videos right now of all this police brutality going on. It's just, man, you can't even walk down the street. Because they just, they're just in fear of everything about us. I mean, we can't even walk. You know, a big guy like me walk past a car. I've had women lock the door, like black women lock the door, and I'm just like, I heard the door click, and I didn't even look at you. I just walked past, and I heard you lock the door, and I'm thinking, I didn't even look at you. I'm just walking to my car. But they're so prone to it and so used to it due to the effects of trauma that they just, you know, what, something may not even be about to happen, and they're just in fear. And that's just that trauma of always thinking that someone's out to get me and something is going to happen to me because, you know, I've dealt with that before.
Let's talk about that. Now, you hit it right on there. It's like, okay, so let's dig into this thing. We talked about what the symptoms of trauma is. And brothers and sisters that are listening, you know, you're listening to Nat Turner Library Radio. This is the kind of stuff we talk about, not for the purpose. This is not a show where we try to make you feel bad. This show is about solutions. So let's talk about some of the traumas. I'm just going to name a few, and if I leave any out, Brother Herrell, just go ahead and add on. Molestation. Now, molestation is a sexual touch of you involuntarily. Now, it could happen when you're young. It can happen when you're old. It can happen female against a male or male against a female. It could be same sex. Rape is the forcible sexual act against your will. That I've actually heard a couple of years back, brother. Four years ago, mm-hmm. to be exact. Uh-huh. There was a brother who was a football coach, and he was coaching teenagers. Yeah. He told me flat out, right here in the city of Atlanta, he had a young man on his team that was raped by a woman in his neighborhood. She got him drunk. She gave him some juice, mm-hmm. got him drunk. She raped him and threw him in the street. He threw his things uh-huh. in the street. Nobody called the police and nothing. You know, they just made fun of the boy. This boy was 14 right. years old. That's rape.
Wow.
Okay.
Yeah.
You see someone get shot or stabbed, that's trauma.
Yeah.
You see your mother get beat by your father, or what happens a lot nowadays, mama's beating, you know, wife beating her husband, you know.
Right.
I talked to a marriage counselor, I interviewed him 3 years ago. He said it's 50% based on his analysis, not his opinion, that women attack men in a relationship just like men attack women. It's 50%, and that's what these statistics that I'm
right.
going to show. That's trauma.
Mm-hmm.
Of someone yelling at you, cussing at you, you know, especially if it's a situation where it's being abusive, that's trauma.
Mm-hmm.
All of these things
yep.
are just examples. And did I leave any out, Brother Herrell?
No, you hit it right on the head, brother, with the most, ones that we deal with. It's just like violence and poverty. Poverty is another one. Just, you know, growing up, a lot of individuals, like back in the day, we grew up in the projects. And we're used to, you know, not eating an appropriate diet, dealing with the violence, dealing with the abuse of male and female, dealing with the child abuse. You know, the mother's upset because the husband beat her. Therefore, the mother beat the child blood,
right.
threw the child down the stairs, broke the child arm, all
right.
because everybody's upset because we don't have enough money. We don't have, quote-unquote, enough money to make ends meet. I don't even like using those old terms because those old terms brought on a lot of trauma. The dad always came home upset because, you know, a perfect example is James Evans off Good Time. You ever seen a person that angry on TV? That brother was always angry.
Always
in his face that he didn't have enough money due to his economic status. And then what happened to Good Time? The brother suffered all that long. Then he got a job in Mississippi and died in a car accident. You know, it's a never ending cycle. And those things happen, man. Like people are, you know, dealing with a lot of things all their life, and then all of a sudden they get sick. You know, they're sick and they pass away. They get sick from eating oodles and noodles all the time. They get sick from drinking that sweet red Kool-Aid. That's all effects due to poverty.
Well, we laughing because that's the truth. But I know
yeah.
if you experience what I experience, you know, it ain't funny at the time. You get whooped, you know. And
no, it's not funny. It's not funny.
You know, get yelled at for no reason. And,
mm-hmm.
and let's bring it home now. So we got brothers and sisters that are listening, I'm sure, whether it be today or in the future, because, you know, people listen to our stuff for months to come. So
right.
some brother, some sister is saying, man, okay, what does all this mean? I'm going to tell you, brothers and sisters, and Herrell, you can jump in anytime.
Mm-hmm.
In order to remove the history of slavery from our DNA,
mm-hmm.
okay, I want you, brothers and sisters, to understand what Dr. Rachel Yehuda, she's an American psychiatrist. Her book I posted to the Nat Turner Library radio page on Facebook. She did a research study on Jewish Holocaust victims, and she concluded through her research that written in the DNA is a predisposition for anxiety, depression, and violence, as well as high blood pressure for Holocaust victims. So what do they tell
wow.
you and I anytime that we go somewhere, they do a doctor, they say, you got high blood pressure. Even if you
high
feel good,
pressure.
You got high blood pressure. Well, that's because
yep.
this trauma is written in our DNA.
Yep.
Yeah. And so how do we get rid of this? This is the question. I'm going to tell you from my own experience, and Brother Herrell, from your experience, I want you to, you know, as an expert in this field, I want you to tell the audience. But I'm going to say what I know from my experience. Brothers and sisters, even if you think you okay, even if you're afraid of what your mama, your daddy, your cousin, your sister, your brother, your friends may say, on an individual basis, you have to see a mental health practitioner, and I'm going to describe how to do that, because you don't know if you've been affected by trauma until things happen to you, like you start beating your children, you start getting to fights, you talk bad. I had to tell a sister not too long ago, you know, you can't talk certain ways to people, but we talk bad to people because that's how it was said to us sometimes. And we don't realize it until we don't realize it until the relationship is over. Person gone, person dead, you know, and then we say, oh, maybe I shouldn't have acted that way. It's too late then.
Too late.
Right. You want to avoid making bad situations worse by getting deep into therapy. And so, but Brother Herrell, would you agree with that?
I absolutely agree. When you was talking about how people talk to people, you know, it's a little cliche saying. People always say, well, you're not going to talk to me like I'm a child. Listen to what you're saying. So you're giving somebody the permission to talk bad and harsh to a child. Think about what you're saying.
Right.
We don't even, we just say that and don't even think about what we're saying. So you mean to tell me I'm not going to talk to you like this, so I'm going to talk to your child like this.
Right.
And you saying that and you're not even noticing what you're doing. And like you said, we got to see, people have to seek some type of counseling. You have to be self-determination. You have to be self-determined to get this thing worked out. So when you go off the scene or when you get older, you got to, these things have to be passed on to the generations under us. Self-determination, the Kuji Chagulia, you have to work on these things so we can pass it down so things can get better for our children and our, you know, nieces and nephews and our community.
Right. And brother, you know, that's exactly the truth. That's it in a nutshell. We can't continue to pass this sanity from one generation. You know, I had a brother tell me, well, man, I'm from South Carolina, man. This is what we do. No, brother, they ain't got nothing to do with it. I had a brother from New York, where I'm from, told me, man, this is how us New Yorkers do, man. No.
You know,
this ain't about where you're from. It's about where you at right now, psychologically, specifically. So I'm going to start it off, and Brother Herrell, you tell the audience what you know. Here's how you seek mental health professional, because I'm going to tell you the truth, Brother Herrell. In the mental health field, when a person goes to see a psychotherapist or psychiatrist or psychologist or counselor, they don't know who to see. So let me explain to you, brothers and sisters, how this works. And Brother Herrell, correct me in anything that I have said that's incorrect at this point. All right. So if you are a victim, brother or sister, I don't care how long ago it was, you can be 90 years old and it happened to you when you was 10. If you were raped, molested, abused, brutally, you know, particularly, and you know this, you know you need help if you never got it. So I'm telling you, you need help if nobody told you. What you do is look at your insurance. Now, if you don't have insurance, if you're on Medicare or if you're on Medicaid, talk to them and find out what mental health services or people they can refer you to. Okay, this ain't no public event. This is between you and your mental health professional. Get your insurance card if you work in and you got insurance, okay? And every insurance provider has mental health services that are available to you, brothers and sisters. Let me make this clear. You may not want to talk about it. All you got to do is look at the back of your insurance card or call your insurance company and say, hey, look, I'm looking for a mental health provider. They don't need to know who and why and all other stuff. You just gonna find out if you got it, and then say, look, you go through the list, and you find someone that looks like you trust them to start out with, and you say, look, I need someone who specializes in trauma, okay? Because all counselors, correct me if I'm wrong, Brother Herrell, all counselors don't specialize in trauma. Is that right?
No, they don't all specialize in trauma. You got different things that some specialize in. But I was going to interject something real quick. You said if you don't have insurance, most mental health providers you go to, once you go through the intake process and, you know, explaining them what you're having issues with and all this other stuff, have documentation from doctors and all that. If you don't have insurance, they have a thing called GAP, which that's like a Medicaid, you know, like subsidy, where if you don't have insurance, you can get GAP, and that can help you get treatment for your mental and substance abuse issues, along with health issues. It's called GAP insurance.
Right. Okay. Now, how does now we got a brother and sister. I talk to a lot of people, just like you do, man. And you know what you just said. Ain't nobody heard that. So listen, I need you to say that again. You know.
Let me speak for up here in Virginia. If anybody from Virginia is listening, it's called a governor's access plan. That's for people that don't have insurance or Medicaid at the appropriate time. They can get GAP insurance. GAP insurance can help with getting treatment for these issues. And you've also that can also help you with mental health, physical, medical issues, substance abuse, things like that. They may not pay as much as Medicaid, but you can get help if you can't get access to that insurance if you don't have insurance. And that can help you get some treatment, because remember, even if you go to someone that's a licensed professional and their building or their practice is licensed, they're going to want money.
Right.
They're going to want money.
Right.
And therapy sessions aren't cheap, but I'm not going to say that they're all that expensive. But you know your financial situation, and you know, thank God for having insurance if you have it, because you can get those things you need. Because one point in time, you know, we probably couldn't even get insurance. You know,
shoot, who you telling? I've been there, and Brother Herrell, you know, thank you for that information. Let me add on, and then we continue to talk about this. So let's step on a few toes for these next few minutes.
Okay.
Now, Brother Herrell is a good brother of Scripture. He's a spiritual man, and I'd like to think that Brother Michael is also. And
you are, brother.
You and I both. Oh, I am. Thank you, brother. Praise God. Hey, I try. So let's talk like spiritual folk know. Some of the worst people to deal with these kind of issues are people in the house of God. Some of them.
Right.
So, because of this one statement. Now, I've heard this many times from people in my own family. I don't need nothing but my Bible and Jesus.
Right.
And you know, even in the Nation of Islam, I've heard brothers tell me, man, I'm good, man. I just need my Quran, and I just need to listen to a couple of lectures, and I'm good.
Right.
Okay, brother. Yeah. That's not the truth. Now, let me quote some scriptures, brothers and sisters. The scripture says that Jesus was called Mighty Counselor.
Counselor, yeah.
I'll say it again. He was called Mighty Counselor, the Prince of Peace. Now,
right.
So in other words, you're not going to get peace, brothers and sisters, until you get counseled.
Yep, okay? That's right.
Now, pastor, preacher, reverend, minister, deacon, whatever who's listening, don't get offended by what I'm about to tell you. Some of y'all are not qualified to counsel our people when it comes to trauma.
Absolutely not. Absolutely not.
Talk on that, Brother Herrell. Talk on that.
Yeah, I'm really in agreement with you about that, because like a lot of preachers, and they do their thing, ministers, the reverend, they're professional with preaching, dissecting the scriptures. Like you said, you can't go to a lot of preachers now, because they're going to tell you to pray. Which, let me interject another thing: there's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with that. But Jesus Christ walked with a disciple named Luke. He was a chief physician. A physician chief physician specializes in everything. Diagnosis and physical and illnesses. Diagnosis. So mental illness is an illness. It's a sickness. So he had Luke with him as a chief physician. And you can have you can be a pastor and do your thing. You can be trusted. You can have a good relationship with an individual where they want to come to you and talk about some things. And then what you should do is direct them to go talk to a professional, because,
There you go.
It's a million churches all over the country, all over the world. And in every church, the church is supposed to have everything. And then the church,
right.
you may have mental health professionals in your church, and the pastor shouldn't feel a certain way. Well, I don't want to send this person to this person because I'm the pastor. Well,
right.
That's not how,
right. I've heard
that's
that.
Not how God
I've
looks
that,
at
man.
Things. That's
right.
Not how God looks at
I've
things.
I've heard that. Now, I'm not going to mention this. But I'm not going to mention this one particular pastor's name because he's a well-known pastor around the country, and I don't believe
right.
in slander. But I heard two different national big black pastors say the following statements, and two of them said this a different way. And I'm saying this, brothers and sisters, to you who are listening, so you understand. They understand on a clinical perspective that trauma needs to be dealt with deeply. But
mm-hmm.
a lot of times, they, as Brother Herrell just said, they don't want to give up their ego to a
right.
mental health professional. And it's all ego.
Right.
Brother,
and
I
that's pride.
I see it in the Nation of Islam, too. I see it in the
right.
Moore Science Temple. I've seen it with the Hebrew Israelite. I've seen it with the Duwapi.
Right.
Every one of us in our black groups have this same problem. So it ain't a religious issue. It's a black issue. And so, brothers
yeah.
and sisters, don't let the ego of your religious leader kill you because they don't want
right.
you to go to them. They'd rather you get them the $100, you know, or whatever it costs. Don't
right.
let that happen. Seek
right.
help. Don't make it a group yeah. thing either. It's an individual thing. Am I right, Brother Herrell? It's got to be individual.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. I mean, you can get some things from groups by talking to other people, dealing with what you're dealing with, but the best thing
right.
to do is to go one-on-one, because when we pray to God, we might pray to him in church, and we all might pray to him, but you have your individual things that you need.
Yes, I agree.
And that's another thing in our community. We don't go to get counseling because due to the cultural, you know, competency of not thinking that, oh, I don't want to go talk to, no offense, I don't want to go talk to an old white man about my issues, because that's why we need more brothers and sisters to, you know, get involved in this field. I mean, whichever job you're going to do, you're not going to make. I mean, you can make good money. Don't get me wrong. You can make six figures, but it's not going to always be what you think that you're supposed to get. So we need more
right.
brothers and sisters like this. I looked up the top black schools, and Fisk and Hampton and Howard and North Carolina A&T. Majority of all of them now are dealing with sociology and mental health. The only school I didn't think that was dealing with that was Howard. And look at all that
okay.
violence and trauma going on in the city of Washington, D.C. and Howard University.
Right.
I didn't even see the major of mental health or psychology. I did, but in all the other ones, Spelman and Morehouse and Fisk and Louisiana, I saw it in those schools.
Got you. And I may add on to what Brother Harrell's saying. Brothers and sisters, if you not sure of a career but you love people, go into the mental
yeah.
health field, please.
Yeah.
We need as many mental health practitioners in the black community as we
mm-hmm.
can get. And to Ray Ray, who may be listening in the hood, you selling weed, if you selling weed, you're not a mental health practitioner, brother. You selling
right.
weed, you know?
right.
And to the sister who a prostitute, you're not a mental health practitioner. You selling something else that you ain't supposed to sell,
yeah.
you know?
Right.
But I had a sister tell me that long time ago when I was selling the final calls in Virginia, Brother Herrell.
Yeah.
She said, I help my people. She said, I'm a stripper.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
said,
wow.
No, the sister was serious. She said, I take care of all these lonely husbands.
Wow. Isn't that something?
And I said, she was serious. I said, sister, you ain't helping nobody marriage.
Right.
You're breaking homes. You ain't making homes. Hey, Herrell, before we
yep.
close out the show, I want to talk to you about these statistics on this survey. I took
right.
a survey. I had people do a survey. We got quite a few responses and some surprises. I'm going to read them real quick, and then you translate them for us and see. That this had to do with trauma. And so
okay.
everyone on here was black. We have 50% brothers, 50% sisters. But here's the interesting thing. Most of the people on here there's only 78%, excuse me, 68% of the people on here were not married and happy. Mm-hmm. I'll say it again. Now, this is what they call scant sampling. So I can think those numbers are good because we took a survey like this a couple of years ago and it was very sad. So 68% of black folk, male and female, are not married and happy. All right. So this has to do with the trauma. One of the biggest challenges, 50% of the people said communication.
Right.
Others said money and lack of trust. You can't communicate right, brothers and sisters, if you've been traumatized because your brain don't work like everybody else. You heard the ACE study that we quoted earlier. If you've been traumatized, your brain is altered. Am I right, Brother Herrell?
That's right.
Your brain is altered.
That's absolutely
if you've been
right.
traumatized. You may think you're cool, but you're not. So let's go on to the other statistics, all right? We talked about the numbers. Okay. All right, the people who are in a relationship, the majority of the people in a relationship were there for a long time. That's 11 to 20 years, so that's good.
Right.
Okay, that's of the 32% that were in a relationship. All right, so that's hard to do. All right, now here's where I think you're going to find this interesting, Brother Herrell. The question I ask is, where did you learn about intimate relationships? Where did you learn about intimate relationships? And check this out. 33% said they learned about intimate relationships from their mother.
Wow.
Okay. 20% said they learned it from their father.
Mm-hmm.
Another 30% said they learned from their friends and mm-hmm. books. Now check this out.
Okay.
One of the answers I gave was religious house of worship.
Wow.
Only 4% said they learned about intimate relationships from their religious house of worship. Now, this is from different denominations, different faiths in the black diaspora. Now, I want you to comment on that because as far as you and I know, the only place in the world that can tell you how to deal with a relationship according to the origins of it is the house of God.
Right.
Or it should be at least. But only 4% of the black population says that. So you want to comment on that, Brother Herrell?
Yeah, you know, you can go to church, you know, all you want. Don't get me wrong. You can go to church. You can have God, you know, in the midst of your marriage. But unless you and your wife or you and your husband can sit down and communicate things, none of those other things are going to work. Because especially with the men, we got to learn how to take control. And I'm not talking about vibrating and demeaning control. We got to learn how to be more responsible with our wives. We got to learn how to not be so emotional when they get emotional. Women are the weaker vessel.
Right.
And a lot of the blame, a lot of marriages fall apart because, like you said, we cannot communicate without yelling and getting mad. When the check ain't right and the bills come, the first thing we do is get mad, come home upset. We should be thankful that we made it home. Then we come home upset, and then here we go, all the yelling and all that stuff going on. And this is on a Friday. This is on a Monday. You just went to church on a Sunday. So those things you learn in church, you should be applying those things to your marriage. Because Christ told us to love our wives like he loved the church.
Right, right.
And until we can do that and develop relationships with our significant other, we're going to always have problems. I mean, but unless we learn how to deal with it and communicate and rationalize and, you know, be considerate and, you know, things like that, we're going to have issues in a black marriage due to trauma. Because we were never taught how to deal with struggle. Just deal with it, suppress it, keep it moving. We are, you know, we were some of the most, I don't want to use the word ignorant, but, you know, we were some of the most that was uneducated on how to deal with trauma.
Absolutely. And that's the next question on this survey, Brother Herrell. And the question I asked was, have any of these ever happened to you? And the listing I had was rape, molestation, incest, traumatic assault, witnessing a parent divorced, or have you been sexually humiliated publicly? 55% said yes to all of those.
Man, that's rough.
Black community now. Now it's rough. Man. Now I'm gonna get to now. This is gonna be interesting because this is what you were saying earlier. I asked another question. Have you ever physically assaulted another human? 50% said yes. They have.
Absolutely.
And here's the last question. Then I want you to comment on all of this. Have you ever been under the counsel of a professional mental health practitioner, ever?
Right.
84% said no. They have never seen a mental health professional. And check this last one out. How many failed relationships have you had so far? 92% have had more than 4 failed relationships.
Wow.
Welcome to the black community, brothers and sisters. That's the numbers right there. So, Brother Herrell, talk to us real quick. We got about 3 minutes before we got to close out the show.
I was thinking about the part about assaulting another person. Mostly everybody have said yes to that because, you know, that's another piece of trauma that was trickled down on us. Back in those days, those slavery, those segregation days, the man, you know, the man would go to the corner store, get drunk, and they'd be out there fighting all weekend. And then,
and then
when that was over, they went home and they fought. When they fought with their wife and they fought with each other, I had one lady tell me every Friday, even if my dad or mom got paid, we always knew that they was going to get drunk and be fighting before the night was over. How was that a way to live as a child? Yeah, how was that a way to live as a child? You're a teenager, you 13 and 14, 15, 16, and that's all you look forward to. Friday night is a Friday night show between my mom and my dad when actually we supposed to, you know, we supposed to be having family time. And those are just another effect of trauma, just always seeing that and not really having any other alternative but to see abuse. Can't have a good relationship with an opposite sex or a significant other or whatever because don't know how to communicate. Don't know how to do anything but, you know,
yell and scream, and fight.
Yeah.
And
that's why it's good to get.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
No, I was going to say that I was agreeing with you.
That's why it's good. It's good even now. You feel you have some issues, you need to get some family counseling for everybody. You know, when you talk to someone in church, the first thing they say, go talk to the pastor for marriage counseling. Well, the pastor can give you advice. I'm not saying that. And pastors, you know, some of them have good, wise counseling based off experience. But I mean, if a pastor been married for 3 years, and you've been married for 4 years, somebody say, "Go talk to the pastor." It's like, what?
I need to go talk
to somebody that can really give me some different options, some different interventions, some different goals, and you know, some different objectives that we can follow. And what you can do is set a timeline. You know, I want to be able to not argue 6 days out the week within 3 months. And when I come back in 3 months, you know, I want to be able to talk to my therapist and let them know this is what happened when things appear to begin, you know, a little rough. We was able to sit down and talk or go in a room and listen to music. You know, you know, people look at those things as, nobody's really going to deep breathe when they get upset. Well, those things work.
They sure do.
Those things work.
Doing
things like aromatherapy and yoga and just relaxation, those things work, man, because we have been so used and prone to trauma. That's all we know.
There's a Muslim saying we have, Brother Herrell. I want to say this real quick, and then I'll ask you to tell the people how they can get in contact with you if you need. It's a saying of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. He said, if you're angry, then don't say anything. He said, if you are still angry, sit down. If you're still angry while you're sitting down, lay down. If you're still angry when you're laying down, close your eyes.
Wow.
And the point he was trying to make is you should never talk or do anything when you're angry.
Wow.
I'll say it again. That was the point he was making. He said, if you're angry, don't say nothing.
Right.
I mean, and I violated that, but I mean, you know, I think the reality we all have, right? But it's, you know, anger is a destructive thing.
Yeah.
You can kill somebody and be like, I don't know what happened, you know?
Right.
So, Brother Herrell, there's somebody listening into this show today or next week or next month. They want to get in contact with you because they need to know what to do next on certain things. How can they get in contact with you, brother?
They can call me. My phone is always open. The number is 757-609-8843. I'll say it again. 757-609-8843. You can call me, talk to me. I can, you know, assist you with getting to someone, you know, that can, you know, in your area that can, you know, provide you with help. I can give you advice, give you some good encouragement, pray with you, whatever you need. That I also can be emailed at hmitchell8@yahoo.com. That's H as in Herrell, Mitchell, M as in Mary, I as in ice, T as in Tom, C as in cat, H as in Herrell, E as in egg, L as in love, the letter 8, which means regeneration. The letter 8 means a new start, a restart. You can email me, hmitchell8@yahoo.com.
Beautiful, beautiful. Brother Herrell, do you have any final comments for the audience before we close out this subject?
For the audience listening tonight on the East Coast at 9:56 p.m., just want to continue to encourage you if you're feeling some trauma, if you're feeling depressed, feeling suicidal. These are all natural things. And go out and seek help. I have my number, my information. Email me or call me, and I'm going to do my best to help you. I'm going to do my best to link you to the right people in your area. And we can just make things better, not only for ourselves, but for our generations to come. Thank you.
Brother Herrell, this is Brother Herrell, brothers and sisters. He is truly a brother. He has a wonderful spirit. I love this brother as my brother. And thank you, brother. Thank you. And I want to thank you for giving us some wonderful information that many will feed on. We're going to try to do this more often, Brother Herrell, so that, because this is a serious subject, and we want as many of our people, since we're the number one recipients of trauma in the world, we need more of our people to talk on this subject. So we'll be talking about it again. We'll bring you back again. And I want to thank you for your input and your wisdom and your guidance for the audience tonight.
No problem, sir. No problem.
All right. All right. You have a blessed evening, brother, and I'm going to close out the show. Brothers and sisters, that was my brother Herrell over in Hampton Roads, Virginia. And this subject is very, 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 very dear to me, brothers and sisters, because out of all the conspiracies I've read about and all the stuff dealing with this, the Jew, and how they attack us and all that, this is where the rubber meets the road in solutions, man. You got to get therapy. Counseling, brothers and sisters. Get it. Get it. Doesn't matter if you're afraid. Doesn't matter if you think you are right. Get this counseling. Get it. You need it. I need it. We all need it. If you're black and you're American, you need a counselor. Look at your insurance card. They got it. They'll cover it. Okay? So, brothers and sisters, next week, another episode of Nocturnal Library Radio. We're going to have some hard-hitting issues. We're going to talk with Brother Amun Mayat Gev from the Nuwapian. An update on our brother, Malachi York. Let's talk about what they've been doing to him in prison, man. All right? You know, it's a shame because we love that brother. You know, he's done a lot for the cause, man. All right, brothers, sisters, we thank you. I'm going to leave you as I greeted you in the words of peace. Assalamu alaikum.
Amazon has everything for back to school. Zebra lunchbox? Check. Cool Adidas gear like t-shirts.